In a book entitled Bogey Beasts, the artist Sime Zoology combined his black and white illustrations of beasts that might have been, originally published in The Sketch in 1905, with 15 jingles, reminiscent of Lewis Carroll. Later, in 1923, his long-standing friend Joseph Holbrooke, a British composer admired for what the conductor Arthur Nikitsch called his poetical and musical imagination, provided music to go alongside the poems, not settings of them, but complementary to them. Both Holbrooke and Sime shared a love of the morbid, the bizarre, the ephemeral, and the humorous. I know the riches of an ocean cave below the opal twilight of the sea, but all the golden gems beneath the wave are nothing for the likes of such as he. He owns the wandering wood of cobalt rats. He keeps a fourth dimension in a cinch. He has the tales of those Kilkenny cats which fought a l'outrance to the final inch. A cage of attercops which spit like sin. A differential calculus in wine. That bee that haunts the bonnet on a pin. The apples of the piban tree are mine. But he has volumes by the cock and bull, also the star that rounded Tycho's eye, an Amalthea's horn forever full, and in his cellars chained are incubi. My unicorn is of a modish breed, but he has eggs from off the mare her nest. My simple treasures seem but poor indeed, matched with the snides, and so I gave him best. Do cows get bored with chewing grass and sick of seeing green and wish that they were as the ass, inedible and lean? And doth the weary oop-oop yawn, loathing his barren lot, and wish that he had not been born on such a blighted spot? For round the pole, which Odin stuck in lands which always freeze, Hyperboreans curse their luck, dancing like restless fleas, and rage to think of men who pass luxurious lives serene mid fire and water, food and gas, in Barnes or Bethnal Green. Yet these ambitious beings would quit their voluptuous ease to wander in the pathless wood or sail the liquid seas. But all will find, where'er they roam, whatever else they strike, that though they may not like their home is what they like. They have no perhaps not in the zoo, and if you ask the keeper the reason why, he'll look askew and slowly wink his peeper. Then sorrowfully he will tap against his nose a finger and say to you, alas, poor chap, the last one could not linger. He faded, sir, without a sound in a mysterious manner. We did our best to pull him round, but could not find the spanner. The llama, sir, laments his loss. Old yak, he aches with sorrow. I've ordered, sir, another gross. They might arrive tomorrow. Then he will turn away to hide his grief for that lost mammal and squirt some more insecticide on the moth-eaten camel. And should his palm extend abaft, you may, if you feel willing, to help him in his beastly craft, anoint it with a shirt. Not for cash or glory, nor a conceited whim, no tradition hoary attitudes his limb. Not to please a rabble or charm the cultured few, or stir up tongues to gabble of things they never knew. He finds a place a mile hence, a place devoid of lumps, and dances there in silence because he has the jumps. I would do as he does if I were just like he, but would he do what I does if he resembled me? The nunc says, here I'll sit, sufficient occupation, so long as I have wit, to value contemplation. Let others obfuscate the things that should be clear, and let them ululate for all the world to hear. And let them talk and brag, O beasts with ostentation, or wave their parish flag for self-glorification. What is your label, friend, says he to passers-by? What fake do you pretend? How is your weather eye? The nunc says, let me sit. Sufficient occupation, as long as I have wit to live in contemplation. Large lumps of landscape, untidy, out of repair and greasy, the wind vexed and uneasy on the left-hand side of bad man's land. The forlorn ghost of the hoobu whimpers in the glimmering gleaming of the gloaming, no less. But more vexed and disgruntled in its grimly grousing roves the unrivalled gorobobble. Horn mad, says the troll, or up the blinking pole, Podagi thinks it's eaten the insane root and the fruit of the pale flower of Samarkand and blue Lapland rose leaves. The gaffer at the tavern in the forest of gnomes, where the whispering toadstools dance in the shadow of the upas tree, he says to me, say he, it's just pretending. But the pale May Lily Maid affirms that it is said by a highly respectable neighbour across the way that it got a savage bite, all at the dead of night, from the tooth of the puking pute, counting beans by rote, in the caverns remote of the Shadowjacks. And quite enough, she cried indignantly hectic, to make anybody angry. Professor Sherry, LBWFOBNBG, in glass armour, cap-a-pay, sailed away to sea in the Spiridion frigate, the nine-decker, to explore the sloppy shores of Chop Suey, where they chew the poppy. Gorobobble instigated the deep-sea spider to rope the rolling keel in the doldrums and sent the natterjack with the mad apples, which ossified the pineal gland of the skipper. Gorob is closely sib to Gullin Bursty, the tusky one, born in the clouded city built by cuckoos, exiled at an early age for licking salt off of the declivitous heights of the shivering volcanoes of Island Shona, for sticking maggots in the amber cliff, for choking with malice prepense the hypernaculum with stardust. He is deaf, as was the eloquent ass, to the voice of Apollo, and thinks with an abacus. Thank you. A bantling of the pitter-pat in need of his five wits is he, for sniff at it the choresome cat makes life a gaunt anxiety. It worries all with tooth and claw, forever chasing things to chaw. But should the bull's eye glare on high, what time the toadstone gleam below, the iffy-saurus then may ply his craft immune from every foe. He hopes to fake a magic bomb and put the kibosh on the Tom. His mind he feeds with mystery, with magic spells, with artful stunts, for wicked lore and grammary deep in the Kabbalah he hunts. The sleepless curse, I know not why, he put on Moony Jimmy's eye. He stimulates his parlour's brain and gains an intellectual range equal to almost any strain by feeding on a diet strange. The wildest oats he champs with glee, washing them down with ushka pea. Barbecued earwigs soused in tar with mandrake soup, stewed palimpsest, Pope's noses grilled with caviar and toucans' tongues he wolfs with zest. But best of all he loves to munch a kibbered banshee for his lunch. I don't know any noise that I would rather hear than his, the Zoom's, because he joys in music with a noise-consuming gear-iwis. Heard melodies are sweet, they say, but those unheard are what they call a perfect treat, and over every other kind preferred, a lot. Beyond vast heaps of time, outside the vulgar sense perdy, a forest lies sublime. Forever ranging through its groves immense is he. There faded shadows lurk, and there the mouldy sin doth rot. The doom ring does its work, and ancient curses banned by time are in that spot. I don't know anywhere I would not rather roam, and so I do not seek his lair. And would I keep a Zoom myself at home? Oh, no. Once I saw the grasser sit where the waffle wood leaves a lot and barks a bit, like a grown wood should. Said he, with an air of doubt, "Can you tell me true, tell me, when the light goes out, where it goes out to? Tell, oh tell me, what the days change to when they're done. Tell me where tomorrow stays while it's unbegun. Will you tell me, if you know, for my soul it grieves, why the trees do always grow leaves and leaves and leaves? Do you think that one might make trees within this copse sprout sometimes with buns and cake and bottled bass and chops? Do you think that they might grow feet instead of roots? Oh, to see the mistletoe gad about in boots." He did not wait to hear my mind. I did not speak to him, for he capered down the wind through the woodways dim. That yesterday could never be tomorrow fills Moony Jim with suicidal sorrow. It obfuscates his brain with bile and spifflicates his spleen just to prefer what is not there to what has not yet been. yet he himself is neither here nor yonder, in a remote dimension doomed to wander. If I had never been, it would not bother me, I guess, but moody Jims pamper their whims out of sheer cussedness. They dawdle only in those outer spaces so far apart from all the other places that lie outside your furthest thought between the is and not. Ugh, things crawl there that never dare seek any other spot. There are regions of fancy remote where the sog has a mind to remain but a phantom and care not a fig, for he knows his ineffable luck. He has heard what we do to the duck, and he knows of the fate of the pig. And that change would be simply insane, so he chooses to dreamily gloat in the regions of fancy remote. Ah, if beggars were choosers, we might turn old time on a long travel back till he found us a similar rest in the notion that woke us to birth. When we find that the game is not worth all the reckless expense of our best, and it wins not the treasure we lack, far and fast we would hurry our flight, if but beggars were choosers, we might. There are nine breezes perfume the sea in those regions of fancy remote, and the lily-white hand of romance beckons on to that far land of dreams. But a slave in the city of schemes can but envy the sog of his chance to remain, just to dream and to gloat by the shores of the bright fairy where the nine breezes perfume the sea. You may hear the faint sound of the purr after dark of the snitch by the vertigo cliff when the chisel bobs roll down the slopes of the park and the moth dog is out on the sniff. When the elephant fell from the cusp of the moon and the purple-winged sybarite sobbed, the impeccable tone of his humming bassoon to the tune of his baritone throbbed. He was sat at the feet of the elderly bird, and he knows what the wild booby knew, and a great many stunts you might think were absurd, which I will not relate unto you. Vulture Hopkins, the miser, they say, in his lair had a pink spotted snake as a pet. And Gwendolyn Fair, of the amber bright hair, if alive, would be feeding one yet. Living snakes are scarce, but their fossil debris might be found by a scrutiny keen of the primeval shores on an Eocene sea or in slabs of the old Miocene. Go, hunt through Muspelheim or Singsahay, down the blue caverns of Gununga Gap, the dreamy glens of Zoarkam survey, the postern gate of Ghoulish Thabek tap. Seek out the poison pools of dark taboo, or pierce the Mogul forest, dank and sere. Follow the wanderings of the wandering Jew, the wily Kush you will not see or hear. Ask Wallywassel of the Pimply Hill, call to the Takivins or Shuriwile, or speak to Jack and mention it to Jill. Pray to the Ibis, to the Crocodile. Ask Rukunor or ask Moaki Pat. Cotith ask, or Zal the Wondrous Bird, or Billywicks, or Zig, or Mang the Bat. Yet of the Kush you will not glean a word. Nor in the spicy glades of Ginistan, nor where Abaddon preens his murky wing, nor on the awful trail the Yethhand ran, will you find footmarks of that furtive thing. But where the donkeys' obsequies they chant, down where they bury Ned with runic rite, lo, you may spy his shy eye, corposant, wink in the murky purpleness of night. The seeking may seek what he wants when he knows what he aimlessly seeks, but any old quest is followed with zest and keeps him demented for weeks. The seeking will know what he lacks when he finds that he lacks what he knows, but taking of stock would give him a shock and add to the weight of his woes. And if you should guess what he fears, he'd fear any further to guess and pull down the blind in front of his mind to cover his mental distress. The seeking will slacken his pace when he learns it is silly to fuss. He'll follow his toes where every toe goes. He seems to be somewhat like us.
Stuff, got pots and pans galore, sofas, chairs and tables, and carpets on the floor. He found his brains were useless, as many others would, if they but tried to use them, a great unlikelihood. Pays no rent, no taxes, no use had he for pelf. In first is not with servants, he plays with work himself. And when his chores are ended, and he would walk about, outside in he turns himself to get himself. Thank you.